Dr. Pavitra, and today we will be discussing this very, very terrifying topic of hyponatremia. Not just for you, it's also for me, so I thought why not we will read it together. If you like the lectures, please subscribe and share it among your friends, colleagues and junior groups so that we can all learn together. We will essentially be dividing this lecture into two parts. The first, we will discuss about sodium and water balance, outline of it rather. And then we will see how you will approach a child who is presenting to you with hyponatremia. Our fluid compartments is divided into the extracellular and intracellular parts. Intracellular is always the most predominant. Extracellular is divided into interstitial fluid and plasma fluid. Both of them together will make the extracellular fluid. And where does sodium come in? Sodium comes in the extracellular fluid. That is the predominant positively charged ion concentrated at 135 to 145 milliequivalents per liter. And it is the important determinant of plasma osmolality. Any sodium value that is less than 135, even 134, you call it as hyponatremia. See, it is essentially not just sodium that is lost. Okay, water also can be lost. Or water can be more, it can come in various combinations. So what is hyponatremia? When the ratio between water and sodium is increased, water is more compared to the sodium molecules present, then you call it as hyponatremia. And usually it is secondary to more electrolyte free water rather than isolated loss of sodium, especially in pediatric age group. So osmolality. What is osmolality? Osmolality is when you have a solute in 1 kilogram of a solvent. Okay, the number of dissolved particles per kilogram of solvent is called as osmolality. If it's per liter, then you call it as osmolarity. It's just a technical difference, and for our discussion, I think we can use it interchangeably. Normal serum osmolarity is 285 to 295 milliosmoles per kilogram. So technically, I guess you should call it as osmolality because it is per kilogram. If it is going to be per liter, then it is osmolarity. So what are the determinants of serum osmolality? Theoretically, the formula is sodium, glucose and blood urea nitrogen, all in milligram per deciliter and milliequivalents per liter. But see, a substance can be, or a particle can be, an effective osmole only if it does not cross membranes. What happens to urea? Urea crosses membranes very easily. And glucose, some situations, yes, it does, some situations, it does not. So what is the effective osmolality? That is what you call as tonicity. Okay? So tonicity is effective osmolality. Only those substances which do not cross the membranes, you call it as effective osmolality or tonicity. And you calculate osmolality by the formula that we mentioned earlier. So you know blood urea nitrogen crosses. So you cross it off the equation. So effective osmolality or tonicity will be just sodium and glucose. Isn't it so? So with this, you are calculating. When you send to your lab, they can also measure osmolality by an osmometer. Usually the difference between these two should be less than 10 milliosmoles per kg. But imagine a situation where some substances are added to your extracellular fluid, be it cations or anions, whatever. But they are effective osmoles, as in they are pulling in water. So when they are pulling in water and they do not cross the membranes, they become an effective osmole, but they do not come under your calculation, which calculates just sodium and glucose. So when you measure through a lab, your measured osmolality will be more, but your calculated osmolality can be normal. So when there is a difference, when there is an osmolal gap, you know that there are some unmeasured osmoles in our body and you will tend to look for it. So enough about osmolality. What about the friendship between sodium and water? That is what we are here for, isn't it so? See, they are in a very beautiful relationship where the water balance is determined by sodium, and sodium concentration is determined by water. Okay, and how does the regulation happen? It happens at the level of kidneys, okay, by reabsorption and excretion. And wherever sodium goes, again water goes. It is like a cycle, continuous cycle. Okay, water plays a very important role, not just in following sodium. It is also important for maintaining our osmolality. Whenever there are increased osmoles in one area, the water tends to diffuse to that area to make sure the intracellular and extracellular fluid osmolality remains same. So, effective intravascular volume. This is something that we need to know. Whenever I tell the sodium is regulated by volume and volume is regulated by sodium, I mean the effective intracellular volume. What do you mean by that? The total body water volume can be normal or increased, but what is inside the vessels is what matters, because that is what is going to go to your vital organs. Imagine this is the blood vessel and yellow is the blood in it. So suppose there is a loss of water somewhere, or this is going out of the blood vessel to the interstitial space outside the plasma. Then what happens? The blood vessel diameter will remain same, but your blood concentration or the volume inside the vessel is reduced. So this is a reduced intravascular volume or reduced effective volume, despite the total amount of LOs being equal to this LO here. Got it? This is a very important point for our further discussion. So any low volume state will cause sodium retention. Why sodium retention? Because water follows sodium and you need to maintain volume. And always, always, volume takes precedence over sodium. We will discuss that in a moment. What is the basic physiology to maintain your normal plasma osmolality? Imagine there is a volume depletion of some sort. There is a loss. There is a diarrhea. And because of that, there is increased concentration. There is hyperosmolarity in your blood. So what do these things do? Volume depletion will be detected by your baroreceptors. Your hyperosmolarity will be detected by your osmoreceptors. Both of them will cause two reactions. One is to stimulate thirst. As soon as thirst is stimulated, what happens? We go for a glass of water. And this glass of water tries to bring the osmolality to normal. What happens to the second mechanism? Second mechanism is antidiuretic hormone secretion from hypothalamus. What does this do? This increases the water absorption in collecting ducts by increasing the aquaporin channels. Because of this water reabsorption, the osmolality is brought back to normal. So among this two stimulus, volume and osmoles, which will carry more importance? It is always, always volume. So whenever there is volume depletion, irrespective of your osmolarity, the body will try to conserve volume. Okay, so two stimulus, which is baroreceptors and osmoreceptors, two reactions, stimulation of thirst and antidiuretic hormone secretion. Next, osmoles and plasma volume. Whenever there is even a 1% increase in osmolality, there is a secretion of ADH and stimulation of thirst. But for plasma volume to stimulate, a 5 to 10% decrease is required. This seems counterintuitive to what I told earlier. No, no, no. This is still the same. See, the sensitivity might be less. Okay, so against a 1%, you need a 5 to 10% difference. But having said that, say both of them are existing together in a child who is having decreased osmolality due to loss of sodium and decreased volume due to loss of plasma. What is the ideal situation that you will want to be in? You will want both of them to be reabsorbed, isn't it so? But in this situation, even if there is a low sodium, your body will try to conserve water first. Okay? So volume always takes precedence over your osmolality. So despite osmoles, osmolality going down, your kidneys will try to conserve water first. So priority is always to volume, irrespective of your sodium concentration. What happens in a low volume status? Suppose there is volume loss. What happens? We will see. So there is low volume status in afferent arteriole of kidney. Because heart is putting out only that much. And there is stimulation of juxtaglomerular apparatus. Because of that, there is renin secretion. What else can renin be secreted by or stimulated to be secreted? If there is a reduced sodium delivery to distal nephron, or there is a beta agonist stimulation. So all these three, low volume status, a reduced sodium to distal nephron, a beta 1 agonist stimulation, all of these will cause renin secretion. What is renin going to do? It converts angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1. And angiotensin 1 gets converted to angiotensin 2 by means of angiotensin converting enzyme from lungs. What will angiotensin 2 do? There are three actions. One, it stimulates the adrenals to produce aldosterone. What does aldosterone do? It causes sodium water reabsorption and potassium excretion. Next, angiotensin 2 causes increased sodium reabsorption in tubules by increasing ENaC channels. Third action, it causes direct vasoconstriction. So, three actions by angiotensin 2. One is aldosterone, next is sodium reabsorption direct, next is vasoconstriction. So, whenever there is a volume depletion, three things happen. One is sodium retention, next water retention, then vasoconstriction. Okay, so overall, this is what happens whenever there is a volume loss from our body. So to sum up your physiology or sodium physiology to some extent, there are two receptors that are stimulated whenever there is a volume and osmolality, volume loss and osmolality increase, baroreceptors and osmoreceptors. Two mechanisms, thirst and ADH secretion. Volume precedence or volume depletion always takes precedence over osmolality, and whenever there is a coexistence of low volume and a low osmolality, always importance is to volume rather than osmolality, and the effective plasma volume is what determines the reabsorption or excretion of sodium rather than the total plasma volume. So with all this physiology, let us dive into hyponatremia. So whenever a question on hyponatremia is asked, you can start with a definition. Okay, then go to the types of hyponatremia, what causes hyponatremia and what will the child present with. What is the pathophysiology of cause? What is the pathophysiology of consequence? A clinical and lab approach to how will you diagnose a hyponatremia and treatment. Definition we already saw. Any concentration less than 135 milliequivalents per liter is called as hyponatremia. What are the types of hyponatremia? We know that the ratio of water to sodium is increased, and that is what is causing hyponatremia. But is sodium always low or is water always high? No. The sodium can be low, normal or high, and the water can be low, normal or high. It can be in any combination of these. Only thing that matters is the ratio of water to sodium is increased. Water is more compared to the sodium molecules that are present in a given volume. So imagine these three are the blood vessels. So you have 5 sodium molecules to this amount of water, and this is normal water, normal sodium. So here you see there is increased water for the same amount of sodium. So technically speaking, you have the same amount of sodium as this, the first blood vessel, but the water is more. So compared to water, your sodium concentration is less, or ratio of sodium to water or water to sodium is increased. So this will become a hypervolemic hyponatremia, or rather a dilutional hyponatremia. Next, you have a water loss, you have a sodium loss too. But compared to water, sodium is lost more. So again, ratio of water to sodium is increased. This is a hypovolemic hyponatremia. In the first situation, if you imagine the sodiums alone are getting lost due to some reason. Okay, so this is a euvolemic hyponatremia. Volume remains same, but the sodium molecules are reduced. Okay, this is just a diagrammatic representation which you can reproduce easily in your exams, and you can understand the physiology. So hyponatremia can be divided as a pseudohyponatremia and true hyponatremia. A pseudohyponatremia is where the sodium actually may just be normal, but due to one reason or the other, it is recorded as low in your labs. Okay. So these substances are increased protein, increased lipids, increased sugars, or increase in osmolar agents like your mannitol, like urea, like your radio contrast agents. All of these can increase osmolality and it will give a false low reading of sodium. We will see how it is in the next one or two slides. True hyponatremia, as we discussed earlier, can be hypovolemic, euvolemic, or hypervolemic. These three will always have low osmolality. A true hyponatremia generally has a low osmolality, whereas pseudohyponatremia can have a normal or increased osmolality. That is how you easily differentiate between the two. So pseudohyponatremia, usually there is normal sodium, but water content can be reduced. Okay. Why does this happen? Because there is extra solute in the solvent. Okay. So the black one is the sodium, the blue is plasma, and the small lipid concentration, normal lipid concentration, is the yellow. Plasma water is just the plasma. Plasma volume is lipid and plasma together. So what your labs do, they calculate for just one, not both plasma and lipid. And they add a correction to your final calculation to make sure it is actually matching the real values. Imagine there is a situation where the lipid is more, okay, or the solute content in solvent is more. This solvent reduces to occupy the volume. The sodium content actually remains same, but when your lab is calculating, it miscalculates, improperly telling there is a hyponatremia because the volume increases compared to that of the sodium. Okay, then osmolality is normal because lipids or proteins, they are not very effective osmoles. How do you avoid them? You don't calculate this ratio. You calculate only the actual ions by ion selective electrodes. These ion selective electrodes are present in your ABG machines generally. Next is factitious hyponatremia. This is also called as translocational hyponatremia. What is translocational? The water translocates. Here also the sodium content is normal, but the measured sodium is low. What is the difference? The osmolality is high. Remember, in pseudohyponatremia, your osmolality was normal. Here what happens? This triangle is the sodium and the blue circles are the water. Inside the cell, there is some water, and outside the cells also there are some waters. So what happens? Whenever there is some effective osmoles added, it can be anything. It can be mannitol, it can be urea, it can be your radio contrast agent. Because of all this, the water inside the cell sees that, oh my God, the osmolality outside is more. So what does it decide to do? It decides to move outside the cell to maintain your osmolality or equal osmolality between inside cell and outside cell. Isn't it so? As a result, what happens? For the same concentration of sodium, your water concentration is more. Okay? Because of this, the lab reads it as a factitious hyponatremia when actually the content of sodium is normal. Clear on this? Okay, let's move on. Of course, the cell shrinks because water shrinks. I think that is a given for you to understand. So, how do you correct for this extra osmolar agents that are there in the blood? For hyperglycemia, sodium increases 1.6 milliequivalents per liter for every 100 milligram per deciliter rise in glucose. I think that is most important compared to your proteins and your lipids. Every 100 milligram per deciliter rise in glucose, sodium reduces by 1.6 milliequivalents per liter. True hyponatremia. True hyponatremia can be hypovolemic, euvolemic, or hypervolemic. So the sodium is low, but the volume is low, normal, or high. In hypervolemic, the sodium can still be high. The one common feature of all true hyponatremics is a low plasma osmolality because sodium in the effective circulating volume is less. So hypovolemic hyponatremia. There is volume loss somewhere, isn't it so? Somewhere something is getting lost. But where is it getting lost? It can get lost through kidneys. It can get lost through gut. Or it can get lost through skin. Renal loss. There can be a problem per se in the kidney, or the brain is telling the kidney to lose your sodium and volume, or your adrenals is telling the kidney to lose sodium and water, or you are giving something to the child to make the child lose sodium and water, or you are giving hypotonic fluids in the background of volume loss. All of these things can lead to a renal loss. What about extra renal loss? The gut and the skin. How will you differentiate between a renal and extra renal loss? See, if the kidneys are functioning normally, it will detect that there is volume loss and sodium loss, and it will try to conserve sodium. So your urinary sodium will be less. It will be less than 20 milliequivalents, in fact less than 10 milliequivalents per liter. But if your kidney is not functioning properly, then it will not conserve sodium and your sodium concentration will be high. That is how you differentiate in hypovolemic hyponatremia, whether it is a renal or extra renal loss. Clinically, you will definitely have history. You need not go and do a urinary sodium. Okay, any child with vomiting and diarrhea will tell you the history. Any child with burns, you will obviously see the child having burns. Isn't it so? What about euvolemic hyponatremia? Euvolemic hyponatremia, either the patient is input is more or the exit is not happening. Somewhere there is conservation of water and it is causing dilutional hyponatremia. Okay, the sodium is normal here, but the water is more. So water to sodium ratio is increased. Okay, what are the causes of euvolemic hyponatremia? So euvolemic hyponatremia, as we discussed earlier, it can be more input, as in too much water. What happens in too much water and why are we worried? See, for the urine to excrete, or the kidney to excrete urine, you need minimum number of osmoles in the urine, up to 50 milliosmoles. So whatever intake is there, whatever water intake is there, if there is at least 50 milliosmoles per kg, then the urine can excrete water. If that is not there and there is just pure intake of water, there is nothing for the kidney to bind water to. Water always needs a companion. Okay, if that companion is not there, water is not going to get excreted. So if there is psychogenic polydipsia, too much water drinking, or a child is being given too much water forcefully, or it is a very, very diluted formula, or beer, too much drinking of beer, I don't think it is yet there in India. Hopefully it remains the same. Okay, this is very, beer is very poor in sodium content, okay, solute content. So all of these will cause just water intoxication. Your endocrine, glucocorticoid and hypothyroidism also can cause, but the mechanisms are not very clear. Okay, they can also cause euvolemic hyponatremia. On the other hand, there is no loss of water and the kidney is conserving water. It can be either due to the child's increased secretion of antidiuretic hormone, or the medication is being given. Okay. This is SIADH, the syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone diagnosis. That is in itself a separate topic, and I hope I'll be able to make a lecture on it in the future. So these are two causes of euvolemic hyponatremia. Next, hypervolemic hyponatremia. See, the total volume is high here. Okay, the child will evidently present with volume overload, but the effective intravascular volume will be less, because most of this volume is actually in the third space. It can be in the abdomen as ascites, it can be in the lungs as pleural effusion, it can be anywhere else, but not just inside the vessels. So what are those conditions? We know these things. The heart failure, your liver failure, your renal failure, a nephrotic syndrome where albumin is lost, a capillary leak, and there is third spacing in sepsis. All of these will cause make the child appear hypervolemic, whereas the intravascular volume is still low. So these are all hypervolemic hyponatremias. So now you know all the causes of all the different types of hyponatremia. What this child is going to present with? They present with CNS features. Okay. So see, these CNS features are very non-specific. It can be present in many, many conditions. And usually you detect hyponatremia only after seeing a lab report. You don't directly suspect a child having hyponatremia when the child enters the lab, when enters your hospital, isn't it so? So why does the CNS symptoms happen? See, everywhere else, whenever there is a problem, the cells shrink, cells swell, they adjust somehow. But brain and its box is very non-expandable. The cranial vault is non-expandable. So even if the brain cells swell, it cannot be accommodated in the tight vault, and that is the reason for your clinical manifestations. So we will see what happens here. So there is the white cell, the blue water, and the red are small ions inside the cell. The triangles, yellow triangles, are sodium that we discussed earlier. Okay. So what happens here? Let's see. So there is acute hyponatremia on the left side, isn't it? So there is loss of sodium. So what happens? The osmolality outside is reduced, and the concentration or the osmolality inside the cell is more. Because of that, the water moves inside the cell to make sure osmolality is maintained. When water moves inside the cell, there is cell swelling. So in acute hyponatremia, there is cell swelling, but the brain cells cannot be accommodated in the tight cranial vault. So they have features of raised ICP. On the right side, what do you see? There is slow loss of sodium. So what does the cell do? Whenever there is a loss of sodium, it sends out one of its solutes outside. Instead of getting in water, it sends out solute so that the osmolality can still remain the same without any change in cell size. So in those situations, even if the child is hyponatremic to 115, they may not be symptomatic with CNS symptoms because the brain cells do not swell. Okay. Now, how do you diagnose? You see a lab value of hyponatremia. You see the child, you will approximately have an idea of whether it is hypovolemic, hypervolemic, or euvolemic hyponatremia. By lab wise, what do you do? The first step will be to determine serum osmolality. Why? You need to rule out factitious and pseudohyponatremia. Once you have ruled out, whenever you have a low sodium or serum osmolality, that is a true hyponatremia. Next step, assess volume status to divide them into hypervolemic, euvolemic, or hypovolemic. So first is osmolality, next is volume status, next is urinary sodium. Why do you need urinary sodium? Because you need to know whether the loss is renal or extrarenal. So when you put it all together, what is the end result? You have a true hyponatremia with low osmolality. So it can be hypovolemic or hypervolemic. I will discuss euvolemic in the next slide. In hypovolemic, you want to see the urinary sodium, and hypervolemic also you are seeing urinary sodium. If it is more than 20 milliequivalents, it is renal loss. Less than 20 milliequivalents, extrarenal loss. After that, what are the causes of renal loss in hypovolemic? It can be problem in kidney, problem with the aldosterone, problem with you giving a diuretic. So how do you differentiate in a renal and a diuretic problem? The urinary potassium or the urinary potassium will be more and serum potassium will be less. Whereas whenever there is a aldosterone induced sodium loss, sodium and water is lost and potassium is retained. So the potassium increase will point towards aldosterone. In a euvolemia, you do a urine osmolality now. Okay. So when you do a urine osmolality, what happens? If urine osmolality is less than 100 milliosmoles per kg, what does it mean? There is an intake problem, meaning the person is taking in too much of water and the urine is very, very dilute. So you will look for causes of water intoxication. If the urine osmolality is more, the urine is concentrating, it's okay, but too much concentrating is happening, too much water retention is happening. So you will look for causes of increased ADH. It can be SIADH, it can be due to drugs, etc. But that is how you differentiate a water intoxication versus a water retention in a euvolemic hyponatremia. Now you have done everything. You have investigated the child. You have found out the cause. How are you going to manage this child? Management depends on few things. It depends on whether the hyponatremia is acute or chronic. Because if it is an acute hyponatremia, your correction also can be acute. Why? You saw the pathophysiology. Whenever there is acute hyponatremia, there is no time for the cell to recompensate for this change in osmolality. So if you give a correction also early, then the cell improves early. Whereas chronic, the cell has already undergone compensation by extruding these osmoles. But when you are giving extra osmoles very fast, there is no time for the cell to accommodate and it will go on to have osmotic demyelination, which I'll be discussing in the moment. Next, mild versus moderate versus severe. Depends on the degree of hyponatremia. 130 to 134 is mild, 120 to 129 is moderate, less than 120 is severe. These three is needed because it determines your duration of treatment. Okay, so because per day, not more than 10 milliequivalents per liter should be corrected. Now, even conservative managements of 6 to 8 milliequivalents per liter are recommended to avoid overcorrection. So, depending upon mild, you can correct it in a day. Moderate, you will need perhaps 1 to 2 days. In severe hyponatremia, then it can be more than 2 to 3 days. Volume status, hypovolemia, euvolemia, and hypervolemia. You need this because whenever there is a shock, you will still correct the shock first, irrespective of your sodium values, because you need an effective intracellular or intracirculating volume. Your goals or management will be to reduce the symptoms, maintain the sodium levels, and make sure you don't overcorrect. Okay? Why do you need to make sure? I think we discussed this now. So whenever the sodium is getting lost slowly, your cells are also extruding out the effective osmoles outside so that the cell swelling does not happen. Suppose you are giving too much sodium very fast. What happens? There is no time for this to go inside. Water extrudes out of the cell to make sure the osmolality remains same, and the cell shrinks very fast and there is breakage of cell and loss of myelin. This leads to osmotic demyelination syndrome. This used to be called as central pontine myelinolysis, but it is not just restricted to pons, it happens everywhere. So it is called as osmotic demyelination. So how do you manage this child symptomatically? So any child who is presenting with seizures, you see hyponatremia, give 3 to 5 ml per kg of 3% saline over 10 to 15 minutes. This 3% saline has a concentration of 512 milliequivalents of sodium per liter, or every ml has approximately 0.5 milliequivalents. And every ml per kg you give will increase the blood concentration by 1 milliequivalents per liter. What is your goal? You want to raise the serum sodium very fast, 5 milliequivalents from what that patient has presented with. This 5 milliequivalents rise is enough to stop the symptoms. And you can continue with 1 to 2 ml per kg per hour infusion until you have your actual values, you know the underlying cause, and you can do a calculation. So in a hypovolemic hyponatremia, this is where your calculation is difficult, I feel, because in euvolemic and hypervolemic, it is usually fluid and sodium restriction, and that usually takes care of your other two problems. Whereas in hypovolemia, imagine this is the water and this is the sodium. So there is loss of both water and sodium. So what your sodium and water together is getting lost, and some extra sodium is getting lost, isn't it so? So sodium and water, some sodium. So you need to replace this lost volume, this sodium that has gone along with this volume, and this extra sodium. So your calculation should include all of these. Okay. So fluid deficit. Fluid deficit will be 10 ml per kg per percent of dehydration. So suppose a 5 kg child is having a 10% dehydration. So 10 ml into 5 kgs into 5% dehydration. So it will be what? 10 into 5 into 5, which will be approximately 250 ml. Okay, my max is very poor. So do the calculation, 10 into 5 into 5. Okay, so this is the fluid that the child has lost already. What about this excess sodium, the sodium that was going alone? So this is calculated by your usual formula that we all know, desired sodium. Desired sodium will be lower limit of normal, and it should not exceed 10 milliequivalents per day. Remember that. So desired sodium for that day minus whatever the sodium the child is having presently, 0.6 represents your total body water, or your extracellular fluid of total body water, because that is where your sodium is going to go into weight. So this will give you the excess sodium deficit. What sodium has been lost along with this fluid? So you have already calculated this fluid deficit, isn't it so? So in this fluid deficit, proportion from ECF or extracellular fluid and sodium concentration in ECF. So if you do this, you will see how much sodium is getting lost along with the fluid. Or if you don't want to break your head over all of this, just remember whatever fluid is getting lost, it is 10 to 8 milliequivalents sodium per 100 ml of fluid that is lost. Okay. There are multiple other formulas that you can get in the net for calculation. But the inherent problem with all of these formulas, including what I told earlier, is overcorrection. See, why does this overcorrection happen? Whenever you correct sodium, water, everything, what our body detects first is volume correction. Isn't it so? Volume always takes precedence over sodium. So when it realizes the volume has entered our body, what does it do? It stops ADH secretion. So there is no more water retention in our body and water starts getting excreted in urine. Isn't it so? Increase in urine output is one of the very good signs of improving volume. Remember, what happens in our body because of this water loss? So this excess water ratio compared to sodium is getting lost in urine. So endogenously, our body is trying to correct the sodium concentration or the balance between water and sodium. You are also giving sodium from outside. So there will be, and you are not calculating and you are not taking into account this endogenous correction, isn't it so? So what happens, there can be overcorrection because your body is also working along with you. And there is no way for you to know how much ADH stoppage is going to affect the sodium concentration. So few adult studies have tried something called as the vasopressin clamp or the antidiuretic hormone clamp, where they give antidiuretic hormone to negate this endogenous correction and your outside, your calculated corrections will approximate normal values. It is yet to be studied in pediatric age group, but I thought this is something of interest for us. So overall, when a child is coming to you with hypovolemic hyponatremia, you correct the shock with fluid bolus. Symptomatically, you will correct with 3% saline, your CNS symptoms if present. You will do the sodium correction by 8 to 10 milliequivalents per liter per 24 hours. Whatever formulas you want, you can use. You do it with frequent monitoring, every 4 to 6 hours monitoring, because you don't want to overshoot. And then you will do fluid replacement. When I mean replacement, ongoing losses is what I mean. Okay. So all these three are for what the child has lost already. This is for what the child is losing now. A child with diarrhea is not going to stop magically as soon as the child comes to hospital, isn't it so? The child will still be continuing to lose water and sodium. So you need to replace that. And you will have to avoid the complication of overcorrection by close monitoring. So a child who's coming to you will receive deficit therapy, maintenance therapy, what is required on a day-to-day basis also has to be given, and replacement. So what is lost, what is being lost, what is required on a daily basis will be given to a child in a hypovolemic hyponatremia. This will hold true for any GI loss, I guess. Any child with diarrhea, this is how you need to correct. Euvolemic and hypervolemic, we already discussed. The underlying cause needs to be treated and the treatment is individualized. Mostly it requires fluid with or without sodium restriction. So to summarize all that we have learned regarding hyponatremia now, you need to define what is hyponatremia if a question is asked. Classify. You can classify based upon severity, based upon the acuteness of presentation, based upon symptoms, based upon the volume status. Whichever you can remember, put it up. And always try to put everything in flow charts because it is easier to do that way. It will save time. Write the causes, classify the causes and write them properly. Clinical features is very simple. It is just CNS. You need not break your head over anything else. Approach based upon your serum osmolarity, your assessment of volume status. You will do your urinary sodium. And in euvolemic hyponatremia, you also do a urinary osmolarity. And you manage depending upon the volume status, symptomatic status, acuteness of hyponatremia. Complication is osmotic demyelination syndrome. Osmotic demyelination syndrome, remember, it will not present immediately. It will present usually after a few days, usually 1 week later after your acute correction. They will present in varied CNS manifestations. Again, lethargy, again, coma, convulsions. They can have quadriparesis, hemiparesis, etc. So if a question is asked, this is how you need to write. These are my references. Sorry for taking too much of your time. I couldn't consolidate it any further. And thank you for listening to this lecture very patiently. Please, please, please subscribe and share it among your groups. And thank you all. If you need any more topics that needs discussing, please let me know in the comment box below or message me personally. I will try to make those videos. Thank you all.